Harder and Stoughton Audio presents The Words in My Hand by Guinevere Glasfurd. Read for you by Abigail Hollick. Amsterdam, 1635. Ice. I turned about the room toe to toe, making the smallest circle. What I wanted was not there. His clock, his papers, his quill glass, cleared away, gone. I had seen this room empty before and had not minded. Now it only magnified my loss. I did not want a coin or token or keepsake. I wanted words, some note, but there was none. He'd gone without taking his leave. He'd taken what was his with him. I lifted the sheets he kicked down the bed, the mattress cold under my hand. Even nothing has a shape, I thought. It is what was, what could have been. Helena! Mr. Sergeant called from downstairs, with a sharpness I'd not heard before. Helena! I curled my fingers into my palm. Helena! Louder this time, something brittle in him, something about to break. I grasped the banister, steadied myself and went downstairs. I blinked back tears and wiped my eyes with the side of my hand. Below, the front door stood open. All the heat had gone from the house. I walked across the tiles I had cleaned yesterday. I did what I always did, went on tiptoe so I would not leave a mark. Then I stopped. I could see the limousin outside with Mr. Sergeant, waiting. I pressed my feet flat to the floor, raised my head, carried on walking, and did not look down. When they saw me approach, they parted and stepped to one side. Neither said a word. There was no need. I knew what they were thinking. The driver adjusted the bridle, then pitched my bundle onto the carriage roof. "Only feathers in there," he joked, still looking, not blinking. The horses shuffled and champed on their bits. I bowed my head and climbed in, closing the door behind me with a click. On either seat lay a folded blanket, and on the floor a wicker basket with food. Apples, two large loaves of bread, a cheese, some cured meats. Enough for 2 or 3 days, perhaps more. Too much food. The sight of it made me feel sick. The driver addressed the limousin. "We will make it to Amersfoot first, then Appledorn. Deventer is no more than a day further on, if the route is clear. The Issel is all ice with this winter." He shook his head. "You should do better to wait." The limousin snorted. "Some things won't wait." I glanced up as the limousin climbed into the carriage and settled himself opposite. He smelled of tobacco and wine, a sour, unwashed smell from the night before. "Deventer." I tried to keep the panic out of my voice. He took a blanket and laid it across his knees and motioned at me to do the same. I took the other blanket, unfolding cold over my lap. It sank through my skirts into my legs. I turned to look for Mr. Sergeant as the carriage lurched forwards, but he had gone. And then I saw it was ended. There was no going back. The loss stopped my breath. The limousin crossed his arms and turned his face to one side, the grey light flat on his cheek. He must have felt my look because his gaze flicked back. "What? Aren't we going to Leyden?" "Leyden!" His laugh was knowing, his mouth pulled into a smile almost. "I don't know anyone in Deventer. The Monsieur knows that." He inspected his fingernails, or his knuckles maybe, and shook his head at some private thought. "Limousin, please, you're mistaken."
"No mistake. The Monsieur made no mention of Leyden. We're going to Deventer."
He looked at me, and his look said, "I know what there is to know." This carriage made him keeper, lord, master. His gaze hardened and slid to my stomach. His legs lolled apart. I tucked my legs up against the seat, but his knees knocked against mine as the carriage threaded its way out of the city. Deventer. I tried to place it in my mind, but the map I pictured dissolved at the edges. The roads and canals faded into a blank. Sickness welled up in me and burned my throat. I lunged forwards and grabbed at the door. "Let me out!" The limousin pulled my fingers away from the handle. "Sit back, sit back!" He pushed my shoulder with the flat of his hand. He was stronger than he looked. The skin around his mouth had whitened. Red spots pricked his cheek.
All you have to do is sit there and be still.
I rubbed my shoulder where he had pushed me. Prinzengracht passed by. The view squeezed into a small square of window. A thin light fell on the shuttered-up houses, window after window, blank and cold, blind to me. The carriage began to gather speed. Each house we passed took us further from Westernmarkt. To see the city slip away like this was more than I can bear. Deventer, Deventer. Deventer, Deventer, the word beat into my head with the clatter of hooves. What will I tell my mother? The words were out before I could stop them. I covered my face with my hands, and the tears I had held back all morning tipped from my eyes. My breath came in sobs. The limousin stared out of the window unblinking, as if pained by my tears and crying.
We will pray for your forgiveness, Eleanor.
I squeezed my eyes tight shut and clasped my hands together as he began to pray. But I did not know this prayer of his. I moved my mouth, trying to form words I did not know, shaping sounds I had never heard. Au Vierge de Vierge, ma mère, à toi ce que je viens, devant toi je suis le péché repentant, ne me prie pas mes prières, mais ta miséricorde, entends et réponds-moi. God forgive me, God forgive me. When I looked up again, we were out of the city. I clutched my stomach. Oh God, monsieur, what will become of us? Amsterdam, 1634. Books. I noticed him in glances, the heavy ribbons on his shoes, the curve of his shoulder, his black, black eyelashes. I noticed his hands, delicate and smooth, fingers stained with ink. A writer's hands, smaller than mine. Pale hands that made me want to hide my rough hands away. He had a way of touching his mouth, resting a finger against his lips as he thought, in no hurry to speak. I had to be careful not to stare, not to catch his attention. I knew better than to disturb him. I'd heard him shout at his valet, the limousin, when he went in unannounced. I did not want to be shouted at. But how to be quiet and make it all still when the water pumps squeaked and the windows rattled? Even a clean sheet, when I shook it across the bed, made a horrible crack. It made me wince. The more I winced, the noisier it seemed, this terrible hurdy-gurdying at the heart of Mr. Sargent's house. I went everywhere on tiptoe, afraid I'd trip on my shadow. Betcher wanted to know all about him, the monsieur. He's French, I told her. Her eyes widened, then narrowed, and when she couldn't get anything more from me, she nipped me hard. Monsieur, she said, in a way that made us tip forwards and laugh. In the 2 years I had been with Mr. Sargent, I had not known a lodger like him. He was different, even before he arrived. Lodgers always stayed in one of the rooms at the back. Those rooms faced north. Even on the brightest day, the light felt pinched in. Being in there was like peeping out at the day from under a blanket. Some weeks before he arrived, and to be sure the monsieur would be properly accommodated, Mr. Sargent had come with me to look at the rooms, something he never involved himself with. It was the first inkling I'd had that the monsieur deserved more, better than previous lodgers, that something of Mr. Sargent's reputation was tied up with this man. He humphed up the stairs, not used to so many at once. Our French guest is a thinking man, Helena. He needs quiet, somewhere to work. He was quite specific on that. Une chambre tranquille, or trinquette, or trompette, or something. Then there is his manservant, the valet. He will need a room too. A valet? Who'd heard of such a thing? I didn't know if it was the effort of the stairs or all those French words, but Mr. Sargent had to stop to catch his breath. There'd be a lot more huffing and puffing before the day was done. He swung open the door and went in. Oh dear, he said, when he saw what was there. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. I drew my shawl around my shoulders. The room had been shut for months. He looked as though he had bitten into a lemon having expected peach. I didn't know what he hoped for, that the room be miraculously swagged with velvet and satin, and the bed piled high with a half-dozen duck-down pillows, pillows he did not have. I couldn't imagine anyone being able to think other than dark thoughts in here. The gloominess drew in like fog. I was sure it was foggy in France too, but there was no reason to make our new lodger relive the experience daily. Father had travelled. He'd told me what France was like. He went for weeks at a time, on a trading ship to Bordeaux. He brought my mother a yellow shawl, said he'd had it spun from sunshine he'd found in a French field. It was her favourite, and she wore it until the day he did not return. Then she folded it away, and the sun seemed to slip away with it too. Mr. Sargent turned on one heel and led the way out to the larger room at the front of the house where he kept his books. He had so many, too many for me to count. There were books in trunks and baskets, books tied in bundles, books spilling from boxes, some even on shelves, but there were not shelves for them all. I squinted against the brightness. Mr. Sargent blew out his cheeks. He rocked back on his heels, then centred his weight. His frown lifted as a thought revealed itself, and he tapped my forehead with his knuckles. "Gloom is not conducive to good thinking, Helena. Monsieur Descartes shall have this room, valet and books at the back." I nodded, too surprised to say anything. When I had suggested moving the books before, he'd always said no, these books deserved this room. "All we need now is for them to finish that church and be done with that racket." Bang, bang, crack went hammers on stone outside, as if to underline his point. A roar went up as a plank fell from a scaffold. He tutted. "Who would have thought God's work could be so noisy? I'd not have this on Herengracht." Mr. Sargent, wishing for a house on Herengracht would be like me wishing for a tulip on my birthday. Merchants lived on Herengracht. Booksellers live where they could. But I liked Mr. Sargent's house. It was tucked away down a side street and faced an open square. There had been a market here until it was announced a church would be built. Vesterkirk. It was the finest church in Holland. Work still continued on its outside and around the square. I still couldn't decide whether Mr. Sargent's house leaned to the left or the windows leaned to the right. Not long after I arrived, I had stood on the pavement and tilted my head one way, then the other, as if that would help set it right. Mr. Sargent had laughed when he saw me. He had gout and walked with a limp. What a funny pair they made, this tall, lopsided Dutch house and this round, limping Englishman, neither with a straight line between them. Once the front room had been cleared of books and the arrival date confirmed, Mr. Sargent wasted no time in sharing his news. When Mr. Veldman came by, he was hardly through the door before Mr. Sargent was on him. They were rivals in the bookselling trade, not that I heard either admit it. Mr. Veldman specialised in travel books and maps, books of the world, he called them, and Mr. Sargent in poetry and moral tracts of an edifying nature. But when Mr. Veldman called a latest acquisition a tittle-tattle tale of dubious literary merit, Mr. Sargent refused to entertain him again until a quantity of brandy had been provided to ease the hurt and erase the insult. "We'll see whose tale has been tattled," he said, taking a long, slow sip. In the end, the jug was emptied and Mr. Sargent sound asleep in his chair, snoring. Mr. Veldman shrugged off his cape as he took in Mr. Sargent's news.
"Descartes! The Descartes! Are you mad?"
Mr. Sargent ignored him.
"I am flattered, I admit." "But you heard about his previous lodgings. The time not spent at the abattoir was time spent cutting up creatures in his room, some not even dead."
Mr. Sargent swallowed.
"Helena, a drink for Mr. Veldman."
He looked as though he needed one himself. I folded up Mr. Veldman's cape over my arm and went to fetch the tray from the dresser.
"Yes, well," Mr. Veldman continued, clearly enjoying himself, "you can imagine."
I steadied the glasses on the tray. Mr. Sargent had paled.
"And," he said, shaking his head as if telling a cautionary tale, "he throws animals out of the window, live animals, that is, all in the name of his method. Well," said Mr. Sargent, "Lord Hugins thinks he's brilliant. That is enough for me." Mr. Velman covered his eyes as though shading them and let his hand fall.
Dazzling. Perhaps we could arrange a soiree with the brilliant Descartes.
A soiree?
Mr. Sergeant shifted from one foot to the other.
I expect Monsieur Descartes will be preoccupied. Almost certainly. Very busy.
Mr. Veldman arched his eyebrows at the refusal. He took a glass from the tray.
Well, he's an avowed Catholic, you know.
Mr. Sergeant waved the remark away.
Tolerance is all. We too should know that. What he does in his own time is his affair.
I'd like to know what he thinks of Galileo, but no matter. I doubt he will publish, not now.
Patience, Veldman, patience. There is more to the man, I believe.
Mr. Veldman laughed.
Impatience, more like, and arrogance, and ambition. A temper, too, I've heard.
Mr. Sergeant took a sip from his glass, then cleared his throat.
It will be an honour to have him here, with me.
Why, I defer to your judgment on these matters, as always.
He made a small bow.
I think you are jealous, Veldman,
Mr. Sergeant teased. Mr. Veldman laughed once more.
You must allow an ageing man his small jealousies now and then.
He held the glass up to the light.
Very pretty,
he said, looking through it at me.
Come, Mr. Veldman, if jealousies are what please you, let me show you what I've brought from Utrecht.
Mr. Sergeant steered Mr. Veldman towards his study. When the door had closed, I took the glasses away to wash them. Mr. Veldman's glass I washed twice. Flowers. The minister at Nordekirk said terrible things about the French. Their frills and ruffles, silks and satins, ribbons and lace. It was hard to imagine a man wearing such things. Would our French guest have a collection of wigs and drink wine before breakfast and brandy with it? On the morning he was due, Mr. Sergeant sent me to the flower market to buy flowers for the house.
Mind you buy French flowers,
he said, and shut himself in his study without another word. At the market, I looked at what was for sale. Peonies, daisies, honeysuckle, and roses in bright bunches. But what, of any of it, was French? If Betcher was here, she'd know, even if she didn't. Peonies, perhaps. There didn't seem to be a house along the length of Herengracht without peonies in the window. Look at us, they seemed to say. I did not like flowers like that. They could be rotten right at the heart and you would not know. Some shed their petals at the gentlest touch, as if made only of wilting and sadness.
Excuse me, I raised my hand to catch the attention of the storekeeper. Do you have anything French?
The storekeeper wiped her hands on her apron and studied me.
This is what I have.
She pointed to a basket of honeysuckle. But wasn't that as English as a rose? She raised her eyes. If it wasn't for the fact that I patted my purse to remind her I was buying, then I think she would have sent me on my way. She went to the back of her stall and returned with a small basket filled with lavender.
It's for drying, for keeping down flies. I suppose you could try it in water first, if it's French flowers you're after.
I chose a bunch and breathed in the scent. I closed my eyes and saw a lilac hill, a high blue sky, and the sun pink and rosy as a peach. The flower seller wrinkled her nose.
I don't care for it. Makes me sneeze.
When I sniffed it again, she looked at me as if I'd taken the last of its scent.
Buying,
she said and folded her arms. I nodded. Yes, I was buying. Hadn't I a bouquet de fleurs to make?
Bouquet?
I'd asked when Mr. Sergeant had said what he wanted. He'd looked at me and I'd looked at him and blinked for us both.
Bouquet, Helena. Bouquet.
So I put a bouquet of roses in Mr. Sergeant's study. Then I traipsed upstairs again with a bouquet of honeysuckle and lavender, wiping up my drips as I went. I set the flowers on the table and swung open the shutters to let in the sun. I dragged the desk away from the wall and shuffled the chair to the right, then to the left. Vesterkirk. That was the view. But I knew a way to see more. I stood by the window with my cheek to the frame, closed one eye and squinted. A silver square of light danced into view.
Prinzengracht. Not water any more, but a jewel. I turned and looked at the table, the flowers, the empty chair. So he'd sit here and think. Thinking was his work, Mr. Sargent had said. Not like any work I'd heard of. I went to the bed and folded back the sheet to air it. I fetched the broom and I swept. And then I was done. I glanced at the chair, then at the door, then at the chair. I'd only sit for as long as it took to go downstairs and back. As soon as I was seated, I closed my eyes and waited for a strange or fantastical thought to appear. Something French. Anything. But all that came to me was what I knew about already. 2 weeks' worth of Mr. Sargent's stockings, steeping in a bucket in the kitchen, waiting to be washed. And now that I thought about it, I realised that I'd soon have the stockings of 2 more men to wash. The bucket became full to overflowing. I pushed myself up from the chair. I'd much rather think standing up. By late morning, the house smelled of lavender and roses and the spiced lamb I'd set cooking before breakfast. Mr. Sargent peered into the pot, tapped his hands together and beamed. "Marvellous, Helena! Exactly as it should be. All we have to do now is wait." I unhooked a pail of water from the fire and carried it across to the kitchen table. Mr. Sargent stepped neatly aside to let me pass. I needed no mirror to tell me how red I'd become. My feet would be redder still if I slopped this water on them. Mr. Sargent eyed the line of pots on the table. To one side, onions, butter, lemon and tarragon, and to the other, a pair of skinny chickens yet to be plucked. He twisted his beard, pulling it to a point. "Potted chicken," I explained.
"Ah!"
His expression cheered as the jumble of ingredients assembled into a meal he recognised, and this, a favourite of his. I slid the butter into a pan with my thumb. If I could get this done, I could be out of the house first thing in the morning to meet Betcher. I plunged a chicken into the water to scald it, dunking it under with a stick. The water greyed and frothed to a scummy rime. The shitty smell of the coop still clung to the chicken, but I couldn't let that bother me. I dunked it again, swishing it around so the water would get into the feathers. Then I counted. When I got to 30, I started again. 4 times 30 was the time needed for a chicken this size. Longer than that, and it would cook. As the smell reached him, Mr. Sargent took 2 quick steps backwards.
"Well, I'll leave you to it,"
he said, turning away so quickly the steam drew after him. 17, 18, 19, 20, I counted, 29, 30. I hoiked the chicken out and screwed up my face in disgust. The sun was past the church tower by the time the knock came. A quiet knock. I opened the door and there was a slim, pale man, no taller than me, dressed in a plain black cape with a collar turned over the top. No silk or satin, no lace cuffs, no silver-tipped cane, no wig. His hair fell to his shoulders in curls. It was black, flecked with grey like his neat beard. A high fringe framed his face, focusing attention on his eyes. They were as dark as his hair, wide-set and heavy-lidded, and gave him a just-awake look. He blinked slowly, as if the light was too bright.
"Bonjour," he said, and then in Dutch, "Hallo?"
He bowed. A small smile lifted the corner of his mouth. This was the man who threw animals out of windows. I swallowed and glanced down, then opened the door as wide as I could, hiding behind it. It was the only reply I could manage. I heard Mr. Sargent come through from his study.
"Monsieur Descartes, come in, come in!"
He held out his hand to greet him, then turned to me.
"His things, Helena, quickly!"
I peeped out from behind the door.
"No, no, my valet, my limousin, will see to that."
The monsieur beckoned to a man cleaning a pipe, standing a little way behind him on the pavement. He was too tall for his clothes, all ankles, wrists and neck. At the sound of his name, he looked up, tapped the tobacco into the palm of his hand and let it fall through his fingers to the ground. Tucking the pipe into a top pocket, he bowed, first to the monsieur and then to Mr. Sargent. Next to him were 2 small cases, a small number of books tied with a leather strap,
a rolled-up rug and a wooden box, no bigger than a foot warmer. Such a beautiful box, with a brass plate on top. When I went to pick it up, the limousin pushed past me. Passa!
My clock, explained the monsieur. I think limousin thinks it's his.
C'est précieux!
He drew the box to him.
It needs careful handling.
I flushed. Did he think I couldn't carry a box?
Mr. Sergeant led the monsieur inside.
Let's get you settled, and then we can have a glass or two of something. Later I will show you what is to be found in the square. There's Vesterkirk. It requires a certain eye. Nothing like the cathedrals of Paris, of course, but I'm sure I could persuade you of its magnificence. Ah, Paris. Now there's a city.
The monsieur followed Mr. Sergeant into the Voorhaus, and I went in after the limousin. He glanced around without interest. He was older than the monsieur. I could see that now, his cheeks hollowed below his cheekbones. Either he did not like to eat, or did not eat enough of what he liked. I'm Helena, Mr. Sergeant's maid. I held out my hand in the hope he would understand. He picked a piece of fluff from his sleeve and tugged at his rather too short cuffs, levelling his gaze on me. I let my hand fall back to my side.
Please, your name?
Limousin.
It was as though he'd presented me with three poffertjes, held high above his head on a plate, each to be savoured in turn.
Limousin.
His face fell further with each sound I made. The name seemed to disappear like a rabbit down a hole, and by the time I reached it, I'd lost hold of its tail. He looked up with a deep weariness at needing to explain.
Limousin.
It is a region of France where I originate. A basic grasp of French geography is all that is necessary.
Limousin's your name?
It is my préférence.
I frowned.
Voorkeur, he explained.
He knew more Dutch than I thought.
What a strange préférence. Did I call myself Leiden or Amsterdam?
Amsterdam! I did my best not to smile. I took the limousin upstairs so that he could inspect the rooms. He nodded his approval when he saw the monsieur's, but seemed less pleased when I showed him his. He went to the window and peered down into the courtyard. Whatever he was thinking, he kept to himself. We were not so different after all.
I'll leave you to arrange your things, I said, and turned to go.
One moment. If you have a question that concerns Monsieur Descartes, it is to me you must first come. Understand? I am his conduit. I manage his affairs.
Yes, of course. Good.
His shoulders relaxed, and he managed a weak smile. I waited a moment, in case he had anything more to say, but he turned back to the bed and prodded the mattress with grim resignation.
Limousin, indeed, I thought as I went out. Monsieur Sour Lemon, more like.
Whilst Mr. Sergeant and the monsieur ate together, the limousin joined me in the kitchen. He took a little of the stew I had made. It was almost as good as his mother's ragout, he said, and helped himself to a second spoonful.
My monsieur won't touch it, of course. He avoids meat.
I looked in dismay at my plate, and then at the potted chicken I had made. It would not do. I would have to make something else. I'd not be able to get away early in the morning after all. He kicked his boots off under the table and sliced into an apple with his pocket knife, eating from the tip of the blade. When he was done with that, he blew out his cheeks and began a tuneless whistle, tap-tapping his fingers on the table. Mr. Sergeant had said they'd be here for the summer, at least. I looked at his fingers, tap, tap, tapping. The whistle seemed made of one long breath after another. I curled my toes.
Is this your first time in Amsterdam?
He shook his head. If he seemed surprised, it was not because I'd asked, but because I didn't know.
Goodness, no, not at all.
Well, how was I to know their every move?
I hope it suits you here.
Merveilleux. Our previous rooms were not the slightest accommodating.
Mr. Sergeant's lodgers always leave with good word. At this, he gave me such a pained expression. What delight was in the man, I thought. No matter how much sugar he ate, he'd never find things too sweet. Are you here for the summer? All of it? I smiled, not wanting him to think I wished them gone. He shrugged. C'est pas. Le monsieur has a certain way of life, a habitude. First Ordrecht, and then Franeker. He moved his hands to the left, and then to the right as he explained. Then Amsterdam, then Deventer, and before that... He waved his hands in the air as if trying to catch the memory from it. Before that, Italy, Poland, Germany. Oh, we keep moving. Many times I lose count. Poland, Italy, Germany. The names flashed bright as mirrors. I tried to think if I'd seen them on one of Mr. Veldman's maps. I'd lose count too. He considered me with a cold regard, and I knew at once I'd stepped over the line that separated us. These lines were everywhere, doing their best to trip me up. I glanced at my hands. How else were we supposed to talk if we didn't talk? He was a valet, not a bookseller, not my employer. But I was only a maid, a Dutch maid at that, not even French. I was most definitely not a conduit. The lines that were there, lines he had drawn, set me as far away from him as possible. Well, he was a connect. I would teach him that word one day, if he did not know it. It's not about counting. I can assure you, the monsieur needs peace. No surprises, no visitors. We go, we move, wherever, until we find it. Quiet. It's a rare thing. He turned to me as he said this, as if daring me to make a sound. Amsterdam certainly wasn't quiet, nor without surprise. Didn't he know of the crowds Westerkerk brought? And not only on Sundays. Perhaps it was best not to mention that. I poured a glass of wine for him. He held it up to the light, swirled it slowly and closed one eye as he studied it. He looked at me and nodded, then cocked his head, angling his nose as he took a sniff. His eyes widened with surprise.
C'est bon?
I smiled. Mr. Sergeant had gone to some trouble to find it. 2 glasses for the valet, I'd been told, not a drop more. He took a sip, holding it in his mouth for a moment, then took a larger mouthful.
Very good! And to find it here, in such a place...
He stared into the glass as if he'd found France reflected in the bottom and circled the rim with one finger as he thought.
The cold in this country is a nightmare. Un cauchemar.
Cauchemar? I'd never heard a less nightmarish word. It sounded soft as wool. Had he family? I wondered how often he saw them, or if he saw them at all. I saw how his life must be, following the monsieur from place to place without question or complaint, or at least complaints that would not reach the monsieur's ears. I offered him the 2nd glass of wine. He nodded, motioning me to fill it a little more when I stopped halfway. Putting the monsieur in the front room had been the right decision after all. But now I worried about the limousin in that chilly, dark room at the back of the house. I would make sure he had another blanket. Once he had finished his wine, he folded his arms across his chest and closed his eyes. I didn't think he was asleep, but I kept quiet just the same. I did not want to disturb him. He might want more wine, and I had no more to give. After lunch, Mr. Sergeant went out with the monsieur. I watched them cross the square. When they reached the church, Mr. Sergeant pointed to one of the windows, his hand shaping an arc in a broad sweep. He was a great talker. More than once I'd seen his customers shuffling and fidgeting, as the monsieur was now, trying to find a reason to leave without appearing rude. I continued my chores and closed the shutters against the dimming light. The window in the monsieur's room had been left open, and several papers had scattered across the floor. As I put them back on the table, I saw what he had done. The flowers I had so carefully arranged were dumped in a soggy heap. Only a single stem of lavender remained, and this he dunked in his drinking glass. Next to the glass, anchored by an inkwell, a simple sketch and some notes. What a strange picture it was. He had not drawn the flower head, only the stem. But the stem was not straight. When it touched the water, it broke and continued a little to one side and to the water below. I frowned. I crouched down so that my nose was on a level with the glass and squinted. Where the stem met the water, it looked as if it had been sliced in half. I lifted the stem out of the water, then dipped it back in again. "Huh," I said, my hand at my mouth. I thought of the times I had placed flowers in water and never noticed. I would bring him a flower with a stronger stem to draw, just one. One of Mr. Sargent's roses would do. Although I saw little of him, the Monsieur was everywhere I looked, as if he was a few steps ahead, just out of sight. Within a week, we were short of candles, then salt. Glasses went missing from the cupboard. I found them neatly arranged on the sill in his room, filled with grey water. He took an old pewter plate from the kitchen and piled it with candle stubs. On a separate plate, he dripped wax into pools. I could just make out his thumbprint in each. I left it all as I found it. I knew better than to touch. He did not leave his room before midday, then went out, sending the limousin on errands in the opposite direction. If Mr. Sargent had been looking forward to the Monsieur's company at mealtimes, he was disappointed, as the Monsieur preferred to eat in his room. He frequently did not return until after dinner, and I'd hear him pace up and down until late into the night. I put a little food for him under a dish and left it on a tray by his door. That way, I learned what he liked and what he didn't. I found out he had a sweet tooth. I made apple cake with cinnamon. I strained buttermilk through muslin and flavoured it with vanilla to make hangop. Those dishes always came back empty. There were days when the Monsieur did not go out and I had to clean his room with him in it. I would wait until after lunch to be sure he was awake and dressed. When I went in, I'd take off my slippers so as not to disturb him. Often he was resting with his eyes closed, sitting in a chair he had drawn up to the window. He reminded me of a cat sunning itself, neither awake nor asleep. He never noticed me. Every day I turned back the sheets to air his bed, smoothed them flat with the palm of my hand to cool the still warm mattress. Once a fortnight I washed the bed linen and his clothes too. A month went by and I had not had his nightshirt. It was raining, which meant he would be in his room. I slipped in, knelt down and peered under the bed in case the shirt had been kicked there by mistake.
"Are you looking for something?"
I startled and brushed my apron as I straightened up.
Well, are there clothes for me to wash, Monsieur?
Certainly, but Limousin has brought you everything I have. I twisted my apron between my fingers.
Is something wrong?
I have not had your nightshirt, Monsieur.
Nightshirt?
My cheeks burned. He clapped his hands together, threw his head back and laughed.
What nightshirt?
My heart raced as though I had run up 10 flights of stairs. I fled from the room, his laughter tumbling at my heels. In my haste, I realised I had left my slippers behind. I did not dare go back for them and went barefoot for the rest of the day. When I finally summoned up the courage to retrieve them, I found them placed neatly side by side outside his door. Under one slipper was a note. I unfolded the paper and read what was there.
Your slippers. Your feet will be cold without them.
Underneath, a small drawing. I blinked. Nothing was straight. Not even a rose stem in water. Amsterdam, 1632 to 1633. Glass. Vesterkirk was not for people like me. My church was Noorderkirk. I had to walk the length of the Jordan to reach it. I did not mind. I belonged there. I rose an hour earlier than usual on Sundays. Fires that had been laid the night before still needed to be lit and breakfast prepared before I left. I needed to make time for the walk from Vesterkirk to the Jordan if I was to arrive early before 6. I liked to stand in the same place in church, towards the back and to one side,
where the light fell in from a high window, straight and cool. I stood there before God and tried not to stare as the congregation arrived. Soon I recognised traders from the Jordan and maids like me full of chatter until they stepped across the threshold. They gathered in groups and fluttered like pigeons before they settled and were still. There were lesser merchants too, their collars pleated into ruffs so full their heads seemed cut off from their shoulders. The larger the ruff, the greater the nodding, I noticed, when the minister gave his sermon. The larger the ruff, the greater the attention of the minister after the sermon was done. I did not want a ruff and was glad the minister never noticed me. I covered my head with a muslin square, drawing it across my brow so that my hair was tucked away. Mother had given it to me. It was all that was left from a drawerful of linen she had collected for the day I married. After father was lost, she sold one piece, then another, and I remembered thinking, am I not to marry? But I could not ask it. We had to eat. In the end, all that was left of the husband she'd saved for was tatters and threads. There's none but God can help us, she said, and ripped a cloth into smaller pieces to make handkerchiefs to sell. She took in wool to spin, as she had before she married, and she taught me too. Together, what we earned made less than half a man, less than a man with one hand. Linen and wool could not feed us. Thomas, my brother, went to sea. Mother heard there was great need of maids in Amsterdam. I sat quietly as she told me this, no need even to look up. The day I left, she set my shoulders straight. Her thin fingers nipped me as she pinned my shawl with her brooch. She hugged me to her. Her warmth circled me, soft and fierce, and I felt strength in her I'd not known. A hope lifted in me that we might stay together after all. I nudged my cheek against her, but something in her seemed to tighten and stiffen as I burrowed closer, as though the thought of parting, my leaving, had wriggled cold fingers between us. She set me gently away from her at arm's length. Look at you growing. You'll be working soon enough, and when you're paid. I knew she was trying to cheer me, but I'd heard maids only got paid once a year. Who could say what I'd get, or when I'd see her again? I swallowed. And you, Ma? What about you? Now, now. She lifted my chin with her hand. I'll manage. I'll go to the minister if needs be. She patted the brooch in place, but this time when I reached for her, she set me away and shook her head. The world is in Amsterdam. Imagine. Work hard. God will be with you. I know it, Helena. All I knew was what I felt, and that was the weight of everything I had against this proposal, which seemed to have gathered at my ankles and held me fast to the floor. She passed me my bundle and my Bible, and I had no choice but to take them. We walked to where the coach waited. As she watched me go, she wrapped her arms tightly around her. There were all kinds of goodbye in the world, I was learning. I'd be one less worry for her once I'd gone. I looked back over my shoulder and waved, but only her fingers lifted in reply. I had papers with me that would introduce me to Mr. Slootmakers, an agent who placed girls with merchant families. I could read and write. I knew my prayers. I could cook, draw water, and lay a fire. In time, I would learn everything I needed to. Someone would have need of a girl like me. But no one had need of a maid who could write. They did not even have to say so. I saw it in their faces. A shake of the head, a downturned mouth, a shrug, the long, cold gaze down the bridge of a nose, the narrowing of eyes. I saw it all as Mr. Slootmakers traipsed me the length of the single, then on to the Amstel, before hawking me along the Jordan and back. It was a dismal day, and we were at the end of it. In the murk, the houses stood shoulder to shoulder like men bundled in grey coats. Then doors opened to Mr. Slootmaker's knock, and revealed all kinds of wonder, moments of scarlet and orange and gold that were gone almost as soon as I glimpsed them. At one house, the lady came out and stood on the top step and listened to Mr. Slootmakers make his appeal from the pavement. She was like a queen, on a throne, hands clasped together. She wore a blue-stoned ring, loose on one knuckle, as startling as the eye of God.
But it did not do to stare at jewellery like that, and Mr. Slootmaker said so, and so we walked on. By the time we arrived on Vestermarkt, it was dark. Mr. Slootmakers had heard that a bookseller he knew was looking for a maid.
"A bookseller? What meagre fee could be had from him?"
he muttered as he knocked at the door.
"Stand back, girl,"
he said, and tucked me behind him into the shadows, as if my being seen would curse the matter. We waited. A dim light flickered in one window, but nothing came from within. Mr. Slootmakers knocked again, a sharp rap with the end of his walking stick.
"Wait, wait!"
There was a rattle of keys, the sound of them being dropped, then of a bolt being drawn back. An elderly man, with a whiskery beard and white tufts of hair either side of his shiny head, peered at us from the doorway.
"Yes, what? Ah, Slootmakers, I was expecting you. I waited so long I fell asleep."
He brushed crumbs from his waistcoat and cleared his throat. He spoke with a strange accent, as if he had a fruit stone in his mouth.
"Mr. Sergeant," Mr. Slootmakers bowed, "forgive this late intrusion. Do you have someone?"
Mr. Sergeant said.
"I've been left dreadfully short since the last girl you brought, Gerarda, had to go."
Mr. Slootmakers pulled me from behind him and pushed me forwards into the light. He dug in his pocket and brought out my crumpled papers. I could not bring myself to look up.
"Stand up straight," he barked.
I lifted my head. It was all I could do to stand up at all. Mr. Sergeant took the papers and tucked them into his waistcoat pocket.
"Can you cook?"
I nodded. He rubbed his hands together.
"Well, come in. Don't you want to see her references? In this light? Let's see what kind of pancake the girl makes. That's the best reference of all."
Mr. Sergeant led us through one dark room and another, and down a number of steps. The house had a smell like no other, not dirty, not clean. An animal smell, I thought, but neither cat nor dog nor any animal I might have expected in a house like this. When we reached the kitchen, he threw a handful of sticks on the fire, a fire so small and feeble I could have cupped it in my hands.
"It'll soon get going."
He sounded more hopeful than he looked. He picked up a pile of books from the table, then, not knowing what to do with them or where else to put them back down. I built up the fire and set a pan over it, and when all was hot I made pancakes. And when I was done, I cut sugar from a loaf, ground it, and sprinkled it over. He watched me as I did it, with a spoon in his hand all the while, and then ate the lot, standing up, right there in the kitchen. From the sound he made, it seemed he had not eaten for a week. I discovered later that Gerarda had left with 3 days' notice, and Mr. Sergeant had survived on apples and plums and a cheese he'd taken back to the rind. It was a poor to-do. There was no Mrs. Sergeant, it seemed.
"Slootmakers tells me you can write," he said between mouthfuls. "My eyes are not what they were."
I searched his face for a frown, but he raised his hands into the air as if thanking God. For one awful moment I thought he was going to hug me, but he handed me the empty plate instead.
"Wonderful!"
Mr. Slootmaker said his goodbyes, and a short time after I heard Mr. Sergeant go upstairs. The house fell quiet. The only light I had was that around my candle. I could find no more candles to light, only stubs that had burned down. Every pot I peered in was empty, bar one that held an onion. I lifted lid after lid and found great yawning mouths of shadow. I had not dared ask, but was I the only maid? No one to show me how or help? My stomach tightened at the thought I had it all to do myself. Amsterdam. The world is here. What a thing, to know it was there, outside and waiting for me. I was too tired to think more on it. I slept where I sat, my head on the table, my hands still dusty with flour. In the morning I found my bed, tucked away in an alcove next to the kitchen chimney. Above the bed, a shelf. I untied my bundle and set out what I had, the square of muslin from my mother, my brooch, and my shawl. I opened my Bible and checked for the scrap of paper I knew was inside. I unfolded it and stared at the one word written there. Amelia. the name of Thomas's ship. He'd been gone a year already, and I had another year to wait. I closed the Bible on the note and put it on the shelf. Beneath the bed, a drawer with bedding. I'd heard some maids slept in cellars. Some had no more than a hollow filled with straw. I patted the mattress, relieved to find it not damp. It gave gently under my hand. Later, Mr. Sergeant came through to show me around the house. First, we went out into the courtyard at the back.
"The water pump, Helena,"
he said, and took a step back as though introducing me to a distant relative. A ginger cat eyed me from a high wall. I was half inclined to bow. I raised the handle and lifted a length of groaning, gurgling water. At the far end of the yard stood the peat store with a chopping block for kindling. The courtyard led onto a shared area, threaded with washing lines where sheets billowed and sagged. Crows bickered in the trees, then flew up in an angry burst of cawing. I saw two maids come out from one of the houses opposite and draw near. One barely reached the shoulder of the other. No more than 12, I guess. They stopped when they saw me. "Hello," I said. The younger turned to the other, whispered and giggled.
"Silly nonsense,"
Mr. Sergeant said, and went to go back indoors. I glanced over my shoulder as I followed him in. The younger girl spun in circles until the older girl shouted at her to stop. I used to spin in circles like that. Now I had to walk in straight lines instead. When we were inside again, Mr. Sergeant took me to his study at the front of the house. Underneath the dust, the floor shone like glass. I saw my reflection pooled at my feet as though I'd stepped into a puddle, as though the floor had me held fast by my ankles. I took a step back to be certain my feet were still mine.
"Marvellous, isn't it?" Mr. Sergeant said. "A little wax will keep it tip-top."
A little wax? I could imagine whole hives emptied out, and there still not being enough. I saw my days ahead, on my knees, polishing, polishing. A dead ache snailed up my arms at the thought. By the far wall stood a tall bookcase filled with leather-bound books. I knew now the source of the smell from the night before. Books! Or rather the hides that bound them. Next to the bookcase, two glass-topped cabinets had been set on display in the window. Each held a single sheet of paper, printed with a title and name. One had pictures of insects, birds and trees. I knew the letters, but not the words they made.
"Frontispieces," Mr. Sergeant explained. "When there is interest, the book is printed. These are Latin. More and more is printed in Dutch these days, in English and French too. All of Amsterdam will be buying books soon enough, and if every Amsterdammer bought one book, well, when that day comes, I shall have my house on Herengracht."
He ran his hand along a shelf, but was not checking for dust.
"One book is not enough, never enough. What one needs is a library. A library is an investment in the future, Helena."
Next, he took me upstairs to his rooms, a sunny bedroom and a small dressing room, the contents of which appeared to have been emptied out into the other. Both rooms faced the front, directly above his study. The bedroom was simply furnished with an oak dresser and a pair of high-backed chairs. The doors to the dresser stood open, both chairs heaped with clothes, work that waited for me. There wasn't a way to know what was clean and what was dirty. It would all have to be washed. Between the chairs on a small table stood a pair of miniatures. One showed the portrait of a woman, her face framed with hollyhocks and roses. Alongside that, a portrait of a much younger, pink-cheeked Mr. Sergeant.
"Painted," he said, when he saw me looking. "In my garden in Oxford." That was a lovely garden.
Garden seemed like a remarkable thing, like having a flower market to yourself on the step. We had a small yard at home, but it never got the sun. Not much grew there. Above his room and up a shorter flight of stairs was a room with a low ceiling containing papers, ledgers, and a large number of books. His study looked tidy by comparison. Next, he showed me through to a pair of smaller rooms at the back, set aside for lodgers.
"Lodgers," he explained, "keep me in tea."
"Tea?" I was about to ask,
but he had started to make his way downstairs again. Halfway down, he turned to me.
"This is my home. Not what I once had, but what I now have."
"Yes, Mr. Sergeant."
"The house has not functioned well recently. It hasn't been as it should be."
I nodded, though I didn't understand. It was a large house for one person. There was so much emptiness. Room for nothing, such a distance between things. Chairs set apart for no other reason, it seemed, to be looked at and admired. It had never occurred to me that a chair might not be just for sitting on, that you could stand and look at it instead. I thought of the papers kept behind glass in his study. How could paper, the words and writing on them, make for a house such as this and everything in it when the sacks and sacks of wool at home made so little?
"Your reference mentions your father is lost." "We are both refugees in a way, Helena," he said, his voice softening. "Circumstances carry us where we least expect. Interesting times. Lots of circumstances, but Amsterdam is a good place for a bookseller. We have our hopes and prayers. There is consolation in that. And in a good book, of course."
"Yes," I whispered. I felt a long way from home.
"Good," he said, brightening. "Now, as I have reason to celebrate, I'll take tea. Have you prepared it before?"
I shook my head. I'd never heard of it.
"Then a demonstration. Just this once."
Mr. Sergeant stood next to me as he talked me through his demonstration. It involved a series of steps to be remembered strictly in the order he showed me. Afterwards, I realised it was only a matter of adding water to some shrivelled leaves. First, the water had to be brought to a strong boil so the bubbles rose in the pan, but not boiled for too long, else it would spoil. That water could be spoiled in this way was new to me.
"If the water is not properly hot, the tea will not infuse, and the result is insipid, terrible, and needs to be tipped away. Waste like that is too ghastly to contemplate."
Infuse, insipid, ghastly. I liked these words. They made my hand tickle. He fetched the tea, which he kept in his study, locked in a small silver caddy. He sprinkled half a teaspoon of dried leaves into a curiously shaped pot.
"No more than this, Helena, else I shall be bankrupted. Now the water, quick."
I poured the water from a pan into the pot.
"That's it, enough."
I peered into the pot. In a twist of steam, the water changed to a bright earthen colour. The scent as fresh as grass after rain.
"Perfect."
He took out his pocket watch.
"Now to time it."
I stared at the watch, then at the tea. It had darkened to the colour of an old shoe. I was glad I did not have to drink it. I thought Mr. Sargent's house was like a palace, but it was a thin finger of a house when compared with the new ones being built on Herengracht. These went up with ever larger windows, as if they were competing for the sky or for God's attention. Some were built with so few bricks that from a distance they looked as though they were made from air. Others had been built so they leaned forwards into the street, as if balanced on their toes. They seemed to peer down at me, perhaps expecting me to curtsy when I went by, but I did not. At night, before the shutters were closed and all the candles within had been lit, whole rooms shone like golden lanterns. In the blue light of morning, before the sun tipped over the rooftops, I couldn't tell where glass stopped and sky began. It was like standing in an enormous church, open to the sky and God's embrace. One day, on my way back from Bottomarkt, I stopped to watch workmen fitting new shutters to a window that reached up to twice my height or more. I felt sorry for the girl who had them to clean. I had not seen anything like them before, carved all over with cherubs and roses and cherries and wide wooden ribbons tied into bows. Sunlight slanted across the pane. I saw birds swoop down, my own reflection too, and clouds shift behind me. Had I fallen into the sky? Had the sky tumbled into the street? I screwed up my eyes and blinked them wide open again. I heard a crack above me as a window was winched up. A woman leaned out and pointed at me.
"You there!"
"Me?"
"Yes, you!"
She flicked a towel at me. Are you touching my glass? I stepped back, startled. Off the step! Shoo! How dare you touch my glass? I took another step, standing in the street now. No, I... Horrid girl, you touched my glass! I did not touch your glass. Liar! God, take your tongue and knot it! I did not touch it, I protested. God gave you eyes so that you can see. Well, she spluttered. I did not wait to hear more. I ran and ran until I was over two bridges and halfway along Prinsengracht. My heart seemed to grow bigger with every beat until there was no room left inside me to breathe. When I hadn't another step in me and could run no further, I stopped and rested against a tree, feeling around it with my fingers until I faced the canal. I curled my toes over the stone ledge, and although I was laughing, I was crying too. Bruises. Mr. Sargent received visitors most days. Some travelled from across the provinces and needed to stay in the house for a week or more. I learned that visitors from the west liked to speak first, and those from the north did not require me to speak at all. I should not ask about journeys taken, nor inquire after well-being, and never offer my hand in greeting. I should take capes, help with boots, bring drinks on a tray.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.